Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our online service for Sunday, the 6th of February, 2022. We were really hoping at orange level to be physically meeting together again this morning, but obviously with the levels being changed, we're back to red again, so we can't meet yet. Hopefully it's coming soon, but we can still enjoy meeting together on Zoom or this recording, which will be made available for you. So let me pray as we begin. Thank you, Lord, that you are in control of all things. You know, Lord, sometimes things don't work out the way that we would want them to. We have to trust, Lord, that you are in control and you know what's best for us and you will work out your purposes. So as we enjoy this time, Lord, of singing and your word, we just ask, Lord, that you will lead us by your Holy Spirit. Again, encourage us, Lord. We need you to make your word alive. So please lead us, Lord God. Help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's have our first song.
Gift of love and righteousness.
That's a beautiful song, just reminding us again of who God is in Christ alone. God is our only hope. Doesn't matter what we're going through, if it's good things or bad things. Only in Christ do we really have that true hope. So we're going to look now at our message. So I will share my screen with you again. All right, you'll see on the screen there that we're going to be looking at Genesis again. And we're going to be looking at Genesis 26 to 31. So if you've got your Bibles, please follow along with me now. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds in the sky, and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. So I want to just look from these six short verses at three practical reminders for us from God's word. You remember the last time I spoke, we looked at Genesis chapter 1 from verses 1 to 25, the first verses. And there we saw 2 points. In the beginning, God. Just a great reminder that God has always been there. God is in control. He was there right at the beginning. He's with us right now, and he will be with us in the future. God is outside of time. There's never a moment when he's not going to be with us. That's a great thing to encourage us. The second point we looked at last time was that God's words have incredible creative power. He spoke a word and creation happened. And God's words are not just for Genesis. God still speaks to us today. If you missed the last message, then go back and look at that one on YouTube or on the church website to remind us just God's amazing power. And we saw the pattern there in that. It was basically each time, each day of the creation story, God said something, often "let there be light" or "let something happen." And it was so. Everything that God spoke happened just like that, because God is God. There are 3 points I want to look at from today's verses, and the first one is purpose. I've got three letter P's to help us to remember. The first one is purpose. So what's the purpose? Let's look at verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." Now compare that to the previous verses we saw when God created everything, like the sun and the moon and the stars and the sea and the animals. God said, "Let there be." This time it's totally different. God says, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." There's nothing else in creation that's made in God's image, only people. "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." Who's speaking at this time? God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." Us, our. It's obviously God the Father speaking, but it's not singular, it's plural. It says also in the early verses we read in Genesis 1, that the Holy Spirit was there hovering over the world when it was formless and empty, the Trinity was right there in the beginning. Let us, in our likeness, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So be encouraged. We, as humans, are unique among God's creation, both men and women. And I'm sure you know these beautiful verses in Psalm 139 about God creating me, about God creating you. I'll read these verses to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. Amazing miracle of human life. God is the one who knitted us together, who made us who we are. We're made in his image. You are made in God's image. We're tempted sometimes to look at ourselves and compare ourselves to other people. We're not quite as beautiful or handsome as that person. We wish we were thinner. We wish we were fatter. We wish we were taller. We wish we were shorter. But the reality is God doesn't make mistakes. God made you the way you are in his image. Right, guess who? This person was born in Papakura on January the 12th, 1952. This person went to Manurewa High School. This person's favorite sport was tennis. Any idea who that might be? This person only took up serious running when they were aged 19. That's a big clue. This person was the first man to break 3 minutes and 50 seconds for the mile. It was a huge deal when the 4-minute mile was broken by Roger Bannister, but this person ran it in 3 minutes and 50. And then this person won a gold medal in the 1976 Olympic Games for New Zealand in the 1500 meters. You've probably guessed who it is now. He started a charity called Find Your Field of Dreams to help kids get into sport, and many, many kids have been helped through that. And then the person was a local councillor in the Manurewa Papakura ward for about 10 years. Who was it? Let me show you a video now. You'll know this person, I'm sure.
On the curb and can't get away. There's the bell. Walker leads. Hockman second. Bolhut is there. Crouch is there. Clement is there. And Moorcroft forced back around the outside. He's almost in lane three. Can Clement get off the curb there? He's third at the moment, the Scotsman. Hockman leads. Walker second. Bolhut. Bronze medal is the 800 goes on the outside. But the big man from New Zealand makes it now a test of strength from 300 out. Through 200 and Walker leads. Van Dam's there as well. Walhuta right there. Goes past Coughlin. Clement still fighting hard with Wellman. But Walker from New Zealand, the world mile record holder, strikes for Olympic gold. Van Dam second. Wellman comes through the inside. Coughlin's there for Ireland. Clement coming with a late run, but too late. And Walker goes home, as the great New Zealanders have done in the past. In second place, Van Dam. And third was Coughlin. Third was Wellman, fourth
Coughlin,
and five Clement.
Did you guess who it was? Of course, John Walker. Okay, so John Walker was the one there. So if you go to Manurewa now, you'll see that statue of him there wearing his number 694 to commemorate all that he did. So why is this statue here? Why do we put statues? Statues are actually images of the person. This is what John Piper said. If you create an image, if you make a sculpture of someone, you do it to display something about that someone. You put it in the square in the middle of town. You want people to look at it, notice it, think about that person, think something about them. They were noble, or strong or wise or courageous or something. So the statue of John Walker is there for us to remember him. That's his image. And God created us in his image so that we would display or reflect or communicate who he is, how great he is, and what he is like. That was God's purpose. God created us in his image. That also affects how we relate to others. Focus on the Family says that every single human being, no matter how much the image of God is marred by sin or illness or weakness or age or any other disability, still has the status of being in God's image and therefore must be treated with the dignity and the respect that is due to God's image bearer. This has profound implications for our conduct towards others. So what's our purpose? As Christians, we're called to be like a mirror, to reflect God's image to those around us. Remember, we're made in God's image. As Christians, people are going to look at us and see something of God in us. That does sound scary, because we're not perfect, but that doesn't matter. We're made in God's image. God's Holy Spirit is inside us. So we can live out our purpose to reflect God, to show God to those around us. It's a high calling. Remember, God is there with us, helping us to do that. This is from Genesis 1. Has that changed? I don't think so. God still today calls us to reflect him, to be his ambassadors, his messengers. The second P is plan. We read in verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living thing. That's God's plan for us. God says there that we are to subdue the earth. The Hebrew word there is kavash, which means to control or cause to submit. So God is telling us to control the earth. But there's another word God said to rule over it. This is the Hebrew radha, which means to rule by going down and walking among the subjects as an equal. So if we put these two words together, not just kavash, but also radha, together they paint a picture of us ruling over the earth in a kind and benevolent way. We're called to take care of the earth, to take care of the planet that God has given us. And the command there is to be fruitful and increase in number. That same command is repeated later in Genesis 9:7 to Noah. After the flood, God said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Christian family is God's idea. He wants us to be fruitful and to fill the earth. So according to Genesis 1, what's God's plan for us? To rule over the earth and everything in it, but to do that in a caring, considerate way. Look after our planet and to raise families and children. Has that changed from Genesis 1? I don't think so. It's changed, but I think there's something which is added to it. This is not just, I believe, physically having children, but it's also helping people to become God's children. So part of God's plan is to use us as his children to share the gospel with others so that there can be more and more people coming to know God as his children. So that's the plan that God has for us, to be fruitful, having children, but also to be fruitful in witnessing and helping people to come to know him more and more. The third P there is the word provision. Then God said, where does it come from? I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. Sorry, folks, vegetarian diet. Not a drop of or a trace of meat in this. In New Zealand, we've got some beautiful fruit. I love this season now, and we can enjoy the watermelon, chop it up and cool in the fridge. That's beautiful. Not quite yet, but the feijoas will be coming later. And of course, the lovely New Zealand cherries. We've got such variety of fruit and vegetables. I have no problem with people who are vegetarian or vegan. It's a personal choice. But I would be a bit sad, I must admit, if I had to eat that only. So if you are a meat lover, jump forward to Genesis 9:3. Everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. So that leg of lamb is fine. God promises to provide everything that we need. Again, I gave you the green plants. I now give you everything. The food and our daily necessities are given to us by God. He provides that for us. Has God's provision changed since Genesis chapter 1? 100% not. Remember the very well-known passages in the different Gospels. In Luke, Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, don't worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothes. Don't worry. Why? Because your Father knows that you need them." Psalm 23, verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. I have everything I need." So God promises to look after us as his children and provide what he needs. Maybe this is something you very practically need to hear at the moment. In this COVID time, we know that some people have lost their jobs. Some people's businesses have not done well. And making ends meet is pretty hard for some people. This is when reality hits and we really need to trust God to provide for us and ask him to give us what we need. So in summary, Genesis 1, 26 to 31, just six short verses, teach us about God's purpose. Remember that is for us to reflect him to those around us. God's plan for us to control and rule over the earth, and also to have children, but also help others to become God's children. And God's provision, he's going to take care of us. So relax, God is in control. He's promised to provide for us. Amen. Okay, let's go now to our final song. And then after that, I will close in prayer.
Some wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou
Thank you, Lord, for those words of how great thou art. You are a great God. Thank you what we've been able to think about from your word today. Do you have a purpose for each one of us, Lord? We're not insignificant, Lord. We're made in your image. And you've given us, Lord, a work to do is to reflect to you to those around us. So help us, Lord, to be able to reflect to you to our friends, our family, our neighbors, our colleagues, our classmates. Just to show you, Lord, in the way that we treat people in kind words and actions. Help us, Lord, to realize your plan, Lord, is to look after this earth that you've given us, Lord. It's a beautiful creation, Lord, that you've given us, especially here in New Zealand, Lord, so many beautiful places. Help us to take care, do our little part, Lord, but also help us to be fruitful in our lives, Lord, in the sense of physically having children, if that's appropriate. But also, Lord, in telling people about you, sharing the gospel to help people become your children. And thank you, Lord, that you've promised to take care of our needs, to provide for us. That's a wonderful encouragement, Lord. I pray for those who are struggling at the moment, that you would encourage them and we would see, all of us, in very practical ways, your provision. So we thank you, Lord, for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for joining us for this time, and we'll see you next time. Have a good week. Stay safe and God bless. Bye-bye.